The second book I ever wrote is called A Complete Guide to Four-Wheel Drive Trails in Southern Africa. And I came up here and I researched that book. I used to own a mapping company. It was called Infomap. And the second map I ever published was Namibia. The third map was Kaokoveld. And I came and did the Khowarib Schlucht trail. And I remember it in that era of my work with four-wheel drives. I probably enjoyed this trail. It just sticks out, even now, sticks out in my memory as one of the very, very best that I've ever done. I have a very fond memory of this place. Almost to the day, 6 years ago, my vehicle was parked on this bridge. The water is flowing exactly like it is flowing now.
But the Khowarib is flowing quite strongly. It's such a wonderful thing to see because only rarely do these rivers ever flow.
And it bodes very, very well for my trip to Angola because I understand that the rivers are flowing strongly. And of course, we're going to be following them upstream to find the source of the Okavango. Following that, I went into Angola and found the very source of the Okavango in Angola, deep in Angola. And that television series, I still consider my best work. It's on YouTube if you're interested. And so I just have this flood of great memories of this particular spot. I stopped and I was on my own and I took a picture of some young lads who are, hello. It's a fantastic place. Lucky to be here.
This time I'm in Namibia to investigate remote traveling with a rental 4x4 and all its gear. Paul Marsh, overland vehicle guru and global traveler, is my traveling companion.
This road track heading towards the Khowarib Schlucht. We're doing this particular road just because we want to do this particular road. There's no particular reason why. It's just magnificent. I was first here in 2000. I was driving a Mercedes-Benz G-Wagon and I just remember it was just a remarkably beautiful ride. A day's drive towards the town of Khowarib. Khowarib is a very small settlement and is kind of the gateway to Kaokoveld and the most remote parts of all of Namibia. And we will be camping tonight in a place called the Khowarib Schlucht. It's a valley, and well, I'm trying to remember what it was like 16 years ago, and it was a lot greener than this. This is very, very dry, very, very arid, but just as beautiful in its own way.
The Schlucht is also known for its dust. In some countries they call it bull dust. In Namibia they call it unbelievable dust.
Well, what do you think of that then? Eh? Doesn't it look fantastic? The dust bowls. It's actually marked on the map. Well, I marked them on the map because the map I'm using I drew. And I remember the horrific dust. About a kilometer of it. Just, doesn't she look great? I mean, you could market this stuff. You could bottle it and put it in a can and sell it and just give people the safari look. Just, what do you think? Eh? Bad idea. No, it's not a very good idea. Anyway, there is the Schlucht. Through the mountains in the distance, driving now, you can see those cliffs there. Somewhere through, there is a track going through these mountains, and beyond these mountains is the Kaokoveld, stretching all the way to Angola and the Konini River. We're stuck.
Take the step out first.
We're stuck. And we think it might be because the step sticks quite far down and got stuck on the up as the back was down. So it's possible that that's caused us to get stuck. But removing that is not going to really help us at the moment, because we're going to need to move some sand from the front of the vehicle. And you can see how soft it is. Well, clear some sand. It's very obvious that the step hooked. The psyllium, actually. I just went into the wrong gear. Going down. Didn't give it enough thought before tackling the obstacle. I was too relaxed. Thing is that we're not caught on the axles. We haven't put the vehicle down onto the chassis.
This can happen so easily. We were driving along, little detour around some trees because it was a bit high, low down, with branches that were going to catch the roof tent, and we could see a track, but we just weren't thinking, so we didn't select the right gear. And of course, coming around in this thick sand, heading back up, we got caught. We also didn't think that the rear step at the back was hanging down, which you could flip up. And that acted as a plow, so we got stuck. We tried to reverse back, which is one of the things you do. And right now, the vehicle is not on the axles, which is important, because if you try and get out of the sand too much and you spin the wheels, you go one way is down. The most important thing is to clear the sand in front of the wheels, in front of the back wheels, in front of the front wheels, on both sides of the vehicle, before you even attempt to go and try again. Yeah, this is hard work, and we've been sitting in a vehicle for the last week, and often people's backs aren't used to a whole lot of digging. So I'm very much inclined that when you dig, get down low on your knees and dig like this. If you bend over while you're digging, it can actually put a lot of extra stress on your back. Some people are fine with it. For me, I'm not, so I prefer to dig like this and scoop the sand. Actually, I'm scraping it out the way. I find it works quite well. So it's not just important, the sand on the in front of the tire is also going to stop it. The sand on the sides of each tire create extra drag and resistance, like holding the tire in place. So make sure you make a big effort when you're digging, because you get one chance to get out before you dig yourself deeper into trouble. So make the effort to do a proper clear out of the sand, and then hopefully that one time is all you need. As you can see, what I've done is I've made sure that the sand right under the wheel, that's out. It's important that the wheel, when it starts to turn, gets a chance to turn without having to go over a little mound of sand. Take rest when you do this. It's not a rush. We've got all day. And drink lots of water, because you get up a huge sweat and you lose a lot of water doing stuff like this. And this can actually jeopardize you and make quite a simple exercise into quite a dangerous one down the road. Getting your car unstuck is one thing, getting it past where we got stuck is another. The best line is going to be to take the one that's been driven before. It doesn't always mean that works. You've got to judge the situation for what it is. But right now, for us to get out of the tracks we are on and over a different line is going to be a little bit difficult. So I'm going to just flatten this out as much as I can. Remove the hump over here, which we got caught on. Make sure we fill in this as best we can, so we give ourselves the best chance of getting over here.
Really need more momentum. Let's see if I can get a bit further back.
Very nice piece of driving. It's what I tried to do, get further back. I didn't manage to get as far back as he did. Nice piece of driving.
So what I felt was important is I started going up and I just didn't have the momentum. I had one chance to try and reverse back a bit further past where I got stuck without digging myself in. So that's why I wound the window down so I can actually see the tires. The moment I start churning the tires and they're spinning, I'm digging a hole. So back a bit further, coming up, momentum, but not speed. You want momentum, but again, I say not speed. And as you saw, I came up and gently took my foot off the accelerator just to allow the wheels to not slip, but to get grip. And that's really some of the key things when getting out of soft stuff. You want it to grip, so you slowly take your foot off and you gently let the vehicle crawl up. It's not about aggression. It's not about the heavy foot and accelerator. That takes you one way down and you spend a lot of time digging. We got out quickly.
That was a nice exercise. I had my doubts when you first stopped. I thought, uh-oh, tire's down, but
no, it was good. I had doubts, but
The idea of driving the Khowarib Schlucht was really, it's just a great drive, and we came here to experience a great drive, nothing really, for no other reason. It's what four-wheel drive lovers do. They'll go somewhere just to go there, and the journey is the destination. Not necessarily the destination, it's not necessarily the destination, if you understand what I mean. And this is one such place. I didn't come to stay in the Khowarib Schlucht, I came to drive the Khowarib Schlucht. It's been an insane morning of driving. Absolutely fantastic morning of driving. Actually a little nail biting at times. The sand is very, very, very soft. And here, a green oasis. Look at this. Isn't this gorgeous?
Great.
That's perfect. Right
Bath
here.
Time.
Perfect.
Yay.
Shower time. Not really deep enough to have a bath, but there's certainly fresh water and we can both stand here and have a shower. What a great idea that is.
You just come across the oasis, and actually it's quite important that you understand that this water is very valuable to the locals around. The last thing we want to do is get in here with our soap suds and contaminate the water. So I've got a basin, we'll collect some water, we can wash ourselves, we can rinse ourselves on the side, that's absolutely fine. You'd be concerned about bilharzia in certain rivers and waters. This is an underground stream, but the fact that it's running, if I had to collect water here to drink and purify and use, I would collect it and filter out the bits of algae floating, if I had to. Now, there's always a risk in taking water that's flowing. In some senses, you don't know what's higher up, animals and all that could contaminate the water. So treat it as unpurified water if you're going to take it.
It's escaping. The bowl is escaping. I've lost the bowl, sorry. And now I'm thinking, well, maybe this is a great place to camp. What do you think?
Well, if I was choosing a campsite, it's a riverbed, but the river's actually low down, so the chances of the water coming will be quite a bit higher up. It's nice sand, it's good shelter from the trees, and there's lots of firewood.
It's stunning.
So I'm always looking when I'm looking for a campsite. You know, we haven't come across any local villages, because if we had, we would stop and ask them whether we could get permission to stay. You'd never camp in the riverbed, actually in a riverbed. It is so dangerous.
No, it is too dangerous. You
know, rivers can come down in a flash flood and you just won't even know.
But particularly in summer.
It's deadly in summer. Yeah, summer is, you know, we're a lot less rain now. Little or nothing, should we say. It's very dry. But yeah, this would be a good choice.
Or you can hide. Actually try and escape from other people altogether. You'd be surprised. Even when you do that, there's a very good chance that somebody knows, somebody from the local village will know that you're there. The way to hide is to stay low. Not in the depth of a riverbed. It can be very dangerous, as we've already mentioned. But try and, you know, obviously not on a mound, not on a hill. And also the lights of your vehicle, keep them dull. Don't put them high up. Those obvious things. And don't make a lot of noise, like accidentally setting off your burglar alarm, which has happened to me once. Anyway, so that's really it. And The most important thing about wild camping is that you must know if it's safe to do so in the region in which you're traveling. Doing so blindly in any place can lead to some trouble. So that's it. Personally, I prefer wild camping, but if you're on a safari drive tour, as they have arranged for you, it's unlikely that they will expect you to wild camp, but you might just get caught out and have to do it because of some eventuality or another. Keeping dust out of a canopy on a pickup is a big problem, mainly because the tailgate and around the surrounds of the tailgate are such a problem to keep the dust out. It's almost impossible. But how about this for a solution? We've spent the entire day on very dusty roads. The last bit here through the riverbeds, unbelievable silt dust, the worst kind of dust, the kind of dust that gets absolutely everywhere. Out on this, I've done a lot of traveling in my life, and quite a bit of it in pickups. That is as dust-free as any station wagon as I've ever driven, and it's a pickup with a canopy, full-length door. Problem solved. And significant to this solution is the way the door latches. This is similar to what they use in a container. It latches bottom and top with a lever. Very secure, very tight, top and bottom. It's a bit agricultural to look at, but what a solution, fantastic. I've had now 4 vehicles with rear bumper wheel carriers. And to be honest with you, I haven't been impressed with any of them. For one reason or another. This is Gobi X's rear wheel carrier. Best I've yet seen. Why? Well, it's so easy to use. I love the idea of a gas strut. Very, very nice because it keeps it open. I don't have to hold it open with another pin. It has a pin here on the actual door, which is a safety pin. And then to latch it, I don't have to use all my strength. I can just give it a little thump. My other ones were really kind of heavy duty. My wife used to battle with them. This, fantastic. Really, really well done. It has other bits and pieces which I really like. LED light for the number plate, the towing plug, place for the high amperage connectors, and the Heyman Rees connector for a tow bar. And in this particular case, it's a little step, which is also their creation. Recovery points, jacking points. Best I've yet seen. Well, I have some bad news. Do you remember early on in the series of videos, I had trouble at Cape Town International Airport because I was trying to bring a drone into the country in a rather large box. And the box, well, it rang alarm bells with the customs of people, and then they opened up and they found all my camera equipment in my other bag, and then I had to pay 4,000 rands worth of duty. Well, it was all because of this little monster down here, this little thing called a unique Typhoon H drone. The bad news is that it doesn't work. See that? GPS, acquiring satellites. Cannot get satellite signal. It's giving me 2 red and 2 green flashes. I've been told that on a satellite phone, called the head offices at Unique, and I've been told if it flashes red, that's bad news. Did discover though that this is so shiny that it's almost impossible to see in daylight. It's brand new. Not a good product. So I'm sorry, but there's no flying. This entire project of bringing a drone to Africa has been a complete and utter failure. Hey?
There aren't words to explain today's drive. I mean, how beautiful is the scenery we came in? It's just, this is like a hidden a hidden remote area of Namibia that people don't see.
They don't know. It's on the map.
They don't know about it.
It's on the map, but it's not known.
Yeah.
I mean, how many times have we lose the track? At a moment, and you go, oh, there it is. Because nobody has come.
No one's come through. And you know, that for me is just priceless. When you can get to an area like this, it's quiet. There's no one here. We've come through. How many times have we crossed the riverbeds?
Oh,
the trees.
Dozens. Yeah.
The mountains encroaching on us. And I'm just looking forward to what we're still going through tomorrow.
The Schlucht itself, the valley.
Fantastic.
It just closes in, and then suddenly you're. Yeah.
I'm really looking forward to that.
Amazing.
This is why I do this. This is why I love getting away into the bush and the remote areas. It's time for yourself. It's time when you can actually be at peace with nature and everything around you.
And you know what? To be honest with you, you know what? It hasn't spoiled it, but I don't like technology when it gets in the way. The drone doesn't work,
Look, the reality is, you know, in the real sense, we wouldn't have the drone, but it's here to capture the beauty of what we want other people to see who don't come here. That's why we have it.
I know. But it's not working, and it's frustrating me, and it needn't.
Tell you what, we could put it on the fire right now. It
would look fantastic for a very short. Can you hear them? What I've been waiting for. Barking geckos. They're onomatopoeic aha hills. They're ventriloquists. They throw their voices. So I think one's over there. But really he's over there. See? Did you hear him? He is actually over there. I'm not joking, actually. The sound actually travels in the burrows. So to find them, to actually locate them, is almost impossible. But they're all around us.
Just woken up.
A little later than normal this morning. Sun is above the hills. Bet you wish you were here.
Namibia is a land of contrasts, and few countries can compare when it comes to the diversity of its landscapes. In the next episode, Paul and I travel to the most remote and, for me, spectacular parts of all of southern Africa. Van Sales Pass, the Murrayan Fluss, and Hartmann Valley. Join us then.